Hello, I'm W.T. Edmondson, and welcome to Focus. Freedom often causes unbelievable silence. Well, this is another year, and we are into an election cycle. Freedom is one of those things that we too often take for granted. Freedom is not free, and it's so important for each citizen to take the time to vote, because that's where your voice is heard. So we hope this April the 2nd that you will take the time to go to the polls and cast your vote and vote. Well, we have with us again Mayor Carrie Tergin, and she's up for re-election. Welcome to Focus.
Thank you for having me.
So why are you seeking re-election?
Because this is a wonderful city and there's a lot of momentum moving forward, and I just want to continue to serve as mayor and see these projects through and continue to make our city better.
Okay. As you see it, you've been in public life for some time. What is the purpose of city government and what is the role of the mayor?
The role of the mayor is to lead the community, to listen to the community, to see what the goals and dreams are of the city to continue to grow and thrive and be a great place to live. So definitely the mayor should lead through all of that and working with city government to make those things happen for our community.
As we think about individuals coming forward to present themselves to hold an elected office, there are certain things that the average citizen expect. What is your position on full financial disclosure of city elected officials?
We already do that. We are required to file personal financial disclosure statements with the Ethics Commission, and it makes sense. We want to identify any areas that should be known, and really, anytime things can be made open and public, that's just part of being elected in office and making ourselves open and accessible. That just comes with it. So it's important any chance we get to be as open with the community and the citizens as we possibly can.
What does good mayoral leadership look like?
Somebody that listens and someone that's in touch with the community, being active, being involved, being visible, being known, being out there as much as possible, and leading with a respect for listening to all different angles, listening to all positions and when it comes to any issues, and really, I think, being very tuned in to what's going on in the community in that way. So definitely being open, being honest, and reliable, and with respect always.
What part does independence play?
Independence, such as?
Being an independent person that you're easily swayed.
Sure. I think it's important. You have to be able to listen to all sides and make the best decision. And certainly all decisions will not please everyone, so being able to really identify what is the best and how that will affect all parties involved. We deal with a lot of issues, whether it's zoning or issues such as that that might affect neighborhoods, and finding out ways that we can make it the best development to also be beneficial not only for developers but for neighbors too. So there's a lot of times when it is important to have that balance. A great example is Capitol Avenue. We had property owners that we needed to be tough and needed to be firm and realize that this is what's happening, but also balancing that with property rights and balancing that with what happens when deteriorating properties affect a neighborhood. So being able to be all of those things at once is definitely important, so certainly balance.
Mm-hmm. What is your platform for the second term?
Platform for second term is to continue the momentum. And in the first term, it was really about revitalization. And now it's about building and it's about seeing those projects through. And it's been very exciting when we think about prison redevelopment. And now the city is the owner of 30 acres. And we're getting ready to send out an RFQ to seek development. So that's very exciting. And Capitol Avenue, now we have the streetscape project that was a partnership with the city and county. We finally have ownership of some of those homes to be revitalized and redeveloped. And Riverfront was another big initiative. And now we are seeing through private developers and private donors in our community that that's going to be a project that's coming to fruition, that we will finally be able to access our riverfront on this side. So to continue to see those projects through, and then even more new projects. We heard about the possibility of a steamboat museum relocating. We'd love to have that here in Jefferson City. It needs to be in Missouri, and this is the perfect place for it. So continuing to strive for some of those big picture initiatives. And all of that really boils down to who we are as a community and what are our assets. So we're the only city in the whole country that has a state capitol, a river, and a historic penitentiary. And those are things that are all three underutilized. But working together, if we can really strengthen all those three, we can see an increase in growth, development, visitors. That creates job and economic growth and really pride in our community.
Okay. What is the current image of the city government as compared to 4 years ago?
I would say very positive. There's a very positive outlook. We have departments really working together, and we're seeing a lot of growth in our community. There are things that happen outside of the city government in other entities, such as the schools. We've seen growth happening with Helias High School and some of their sporting complex. We've seen Jefferson City High School and the voters passing an initiative to see that growth happen. So within our schools, we're seeing that. So there's a lot of things within the community that are things we've talked about really for generations, mm-hmm. and they're starting to happen. So when you look at 4 years ago compared to today, we've seen tremendous growth and opportunity, and I think kind of an enthusiasm and excitement about Jefferson City.
Looking at the top three issues that are currently facing the city, what would they be?
Number one is to continue to keep our public safety strong. And we're very fortunate in Jefferson City that we do have excellent fire and police protection. But when it comes to those departments, we're very fortunate, but we want to make sure that it stays that way. So we want to continue the public safety as strong as we possibly can. We're very lucky in the capital city, but we want to have that remain strong. So number one, I think, is that, because without a safe community, some of these other initiatives really don't matter. We need to keep our community safe. So that's number one above all else. But I would say also, secondly, is to continue some of these initiatives of growth, because we want our community to continue to grow and to provide jobs and having a reliable future workforce and development. So economic growth and vitality is definitely very important, and really listening to the voice of the people and what they would like to see in the future, and just continuing Jefferson City moving in a positive direction.
How can the city do a better job of ensuring that the workforce actually reflect the population?
I know that's a challenge. We work with schools, working with Lincoln University and other education here within the community and around the surrounding community, State Technical College, for example, and looking at the graduates, looking at the faculty and staff, and what are ways that we can do more to attract people to those positions that reflect our community and reflect the surrounding areas. So it's a challenge, but it's something we are focused on. The city has recently revived the EQC, and so our HRC, I apologize, mm-hmm. so the Human Relations Commission. So having the Human Relations Commission formed again to look at ways that we can make our community more friendly to all, and how can we be more inclusive, how can we embrace diversity, looking at the city, what are our hiring practices, and working through some of those challenges, because, you know, what is the pool of employees that are applying for the jobs, and then are we looking at the education level as well? Do we have faculty that reflect the students, and are we doing a good job hiring, and what can we do as a city to encourage and help that?
Mm-hmm. You've probably touched on it, but last question. What will be your short-term goals in your second term, as well as your long-term goals?
Yes, short-term goals, some of them overlap with long-term, but in the short term is getting these projects, kind of the way we've spearheaded some of the projects that have started, seeing those now to completion. So with the prison redevelopment, getting the RFQ out and seeing that construction begin, getting a developer chosen and starting to see that revitalization happening and reconstruction. So that is a short-term goal, almost more than a long-term anymore. And a couple more is of course getting the bridge built to Adrian's Island. So now we have the funding, we're getting ready to break ground. Now let's get that built and utilize our riverfront and connect that with the rest of the city and surrounding areas. Some other goals that really have not been mentioned but are very strong in the short term are another parking structure in the downtown. We talked about it for over a decade, and now we have the studies that show the top five locations, so we're going to narrow that down, and hopefully in the next 4 years, the goal is another garage would be built. And we know that we're at capacity when it comes to parking. We have the state capitol right in the heart of our downtown, and part of the challenge is finding parking so that we can continue to grow and thrive for our businesses and visitors. So certainly having a garage there is going to be very important to the continued economic vitality. So it's one of those things that's been talked about, but we're putting that really on the forefront. So that is a goal to see that to fruition. We have a lot of infrastructure needs when it comes to our aging stormwater infrastructure. We know that. We understand the challenges there. So working through the balance of what needs to be done as we construct new buildings so that we don't continue to have that problem. And again, public safety, like I mentioned earlier, is always keeping that at the forefront in all the decisions that we make.
Okay. You spoke about infrastructure. What's the plan to deal with the erosion on Monroe Street going into Dunklin, where the rocks are falling down and you had to put that barricade there? What's the status of that?
Yes, the city is working very hard with that. I know they're working with the surrounding property owners and ensuring that the plan for fixing that will happen. I know that there's a lot that has to happen first, but there's a lot of areas like that. There's also the Dunklin Street Bridge area.
Right.
So certain projects like that, we're seeing the city working towards fixing. A lot of times they're not as easy as they look on the surface, as we've noticed, but the city's doing a good job in working with the partners. I know another great partner in the area, we're working, of course, with Capital Region Hospital and having property there on Monroe and a lot of the surrounding community that goes through there. Monroe is interesting because there's a lot of talk about the need to extend Monroe and what that looks like into the future. So some of these things too, long term, like we know in the short term we're needing to make those fixes, but then in the long term, what does that look like for our community? Some of those are included in future sales tax projects. So that's why it's important that we shop local and support some of those sales tax, because those initiatives pay for some of the long term improvements to some of those areas.
Okay. Mayor Tergin, thank you very much for taking the time. Closing comments, why should the citizens re-elect Carrie Tergin as mayor?
Thank you. I'm very dedicated to this community, love this community, and have it in my heart to continue moving Jefferson City forward. We've had a great 4 years, a lot of momentum moving forward, and I would like to keep seeing that move forward. So I ask for everybody's vote on April 2nd for another 4 years for re-election as mayor.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, WT.
All right. Thank you very much for tuning in. As I indicated, it is very important. Take the time to vote. Your decision is most important. You can't depend on someone else making your decision. We'll see you next time. God bless. Our next guest is the candidate that will be running against Mayor Tergin. So she will be coming in next. And so stay tuned.
Hi, I'm Debbie Hamler with the Special Learning Center, one of the local United Way of Central Missouri member agencies. The mission of the Special Learning Center is to provide comprehensive early intervention services to children with special needs so they may attain their maximum potential. We serve over 500 children a year through our Special Learning Center, center-based program, our outreach therapy program, Crayon Kids, our licensed child care program for children with and without disabilities, and our Capable Kids and Family program. We provide services for the Missouri First Steps program by providing occupational, physical, and speech therapy, as well as special instruction in the child's natural environment. Our staff believe in sensory-based therapies, and we also use a total communication approach for language development. We've served children from 20 public school districts and 11 counties. We're a licensed plate partner with the Children's Trust Fund, so get your personalized plate today. We receive funding through Cole County Special Services, our Senate Bill 40 board. Our Special Learning Center Foundation provides financial support to our programs on a yearly basis, and we rely heavily on the generosity of our community through donations and fundraiser support. Grants of various kinds support our programs each year. You can find our website at www.speciallearningcenter.com for current activities, and we're also on Facebook under the Special Learning Center. We try to be a resource for people with disabilities in our community. If you have questions or a need, call us at 634-3070 and we will help.
Hello, I'm W.T. Edmondson, and welcome to Focus. Freedom often causes unbelievable silence. Well, April the 2nd, 2019, Jefferson City voters will go to the poll to elect a mayor. There's two candidates running, the current mayor, Carrie Tergin, and her opponent is Tiwan Lewis. And we have with us today Ms. Tiwan Lewis. Welcome to Focus, and thanks for accepting our invitation.
Thank you for having me.
Okay, tell us a little bit about yourself. Who is Tiwan Lewis, and why are you seeking the office of mayor?
Tiwan Lewis, I am a native of Jefferson City. I have served this country. I have worked for not-for-profits. I've worked for state government. I've worked for corporations. I'm a mother. I'm an advocate. I'm a community person that some people can go to here locally. And the reason why I am seeking to be mayor is because of change. People need a person in office that can hear, you know, listen to them and help change about in the actual community.
Okay. Thank you. What is your platform for running?
My platform for running is unification for the sake of our children. And with that, it comes with basically housing, it comes with youth programs and more activities within our community. Housing is number one within it, because if people don't have adequate, affordable housing, we really can't move forward. We're talking housing to where people could have emergency housing if they need it, transitional housing if they need it, or shared housing into hopes to owning their own property. As far as youth programs, our youth, as you know, the information's out in our community, the types of things that have been going on, programming is actually needed. Basically, unity is an understanding as far as the future generations to come. And if we do not get a grasp on our actual community, where are the children going to be? As far as the types of cultural things that need to go on to our city to bring dollars into our city, we have arts and entertainment that could totally be tapped into with the parks, with the different facilities that are here that are not being utilized. And so our whole entire community representation is not there. People are not being, you know, represented as far as the types of things they want to view in our city. The youth don't have too many places to actually go, and people really need to be housed to where it's adequate and affordable.
Okay, thank you. As you said, what is the purpose of city government, and what do you see the role of the mayor being?
The purpose of city government is to listen to the people. The role of the mayor is to basically to network the city, to get out and be an advocate in the city, to actually hear what the people are saying, from small businesses to senior citizens, definitely actually the youth. the realtors, the investors, other government entities within the city, and city workers, of course. It's just that go-to person that can actually connect all the dots and give back to the community without, you know, not being there, have an open door policy.
Okay. What do you see as, if you're looking at good mayoral leadership, what does that look like?
A good mayor should basically be there for the people, be out in the community, have that open door policy, being at events, a variety of events, networking the community from all cultures, all walks of life, no matter what religion, no matter what business, no matter what neighborhood, and actually being there for the people. You have to be a people person.
Okay. From your observation, what is the current image of city government?
City government is, from my observation and from being out in the community, is not one that's reachable. Basically, city government, you should be able to walk in, your mayor should be there, you should be able to reach your city councilman, you should be able to find your city councilman without calling them, and just more access. People want to know or have issues, and they should be able to reach their government somewhere in City Hall.
Looking at overall the city, what do you see as the top three issues facing the city of Jefferson, and as the next mayor, how would you prioritize that top three?
Well, the top three is definitely our youth. The first one is our youth. Our second one is going to be housing, and our third one is going to be the opiates. The youth, number one, because they are the future. We have four universities here, Lincoln being where we are today. They need to get integrated into the community a lot better. We have getting ready to have a second high school. We need to tackle that before the divide happens in the whole city. They need some type of community hub so they can stay friends and not have that rivalry that could come about because of the second high school with the have and the have-nots of the different new high school. As far as housing, we need emergency housing. We need a place where if someone is released from Department of Corrections, they have somewhere to go and the police can drop them off somewhere safe and they don't become a nuisance in our community. We need transitional housing for people that may come out of prison, that be, you know, in a fire and need somewhere to go for, you know, maybe 6 to 8 weeks, and then maybe go into a shared housing program if there's a waiting list at Housing Authority. And as far as the opiates, we need somewhere to house the people. Once they get treated, where do they go? Do they return back into their environment where they're going to be more than likely to go right back into the abuse and more subjected to do the drugs? So those are the top three things. As far as what I see to be done, as far as the youth need a community building. We need investors to invest in some type of place where it's universal, that's outside the norm. The Boys and Girls Club can only do so much. We need somewhere for the Jeff City Hub for the youth to be able to come and talk, build relationships, get internships, apprenticeships, talk about the future. As far as the housing, we need investors to open up the buildings, to, you know, make contact with people that are in the community that know how the programs are. If landlord needs, you know, help with screening and different things like that, the city should be there to guide the landlords, the investors, the real estate owners, and potential home buyers, all of that. As far as the opiates, the agencies that are in place, they need more help. They need a place where people can actually go, where all the agencies can meet to be able to truly help people that are addicted, whether it's opiates, alcoholism, whatever drug they may be, you know, involved in.
How can the city do a better job as far as ensuring that the workforce is reflective of the population?
The city could do a better job with basically doing research. We need to see who is sending in applications. Are the applications being screened properly? Who is actually applying for these jobs? To see actually who is not being represented within our city government or as a city as a whole. Once we get those, you know, that information, then we can determine, you know, how do we go about to try to get different cultures and different colors within our city government or inside of our businesses, what is it that we need to do in order to make sure that populations and cultures of all walks of life are being represented in the city of Jefferson.
Okay. What do you see as short-term goals and long-term goals that you would focus on as mayor?
Well, short-term goals for sure is going to be immediate youth, some type of youth programming, apprenticeship, internship, a unified building for the youth to be able to come to and actually get some type of assistance, no matter what it is. Housing is definitely emergency. Of all, you know, the people that have, you know, filtered through our city, we need to catch them, get them housed properly, and get them the assistance that they need. The opiates, the drugs, the things that are going on in the community that is the danger and a threat to the youth, to the people, we need to get that tackled. It's emergency. Those are emergency things. Long-term goals would be the tourist attractions that we have to build. We need to bring it here. It's the capital city, but we have to be realistic as well. We really need to build the things that right away that we can make money with using our parks and different things like that, creating a swamp meet, you know, utilizing these buildings for people to be able to get some type of second income that are living paycheck to paycheck. The long-term goals, the steamboats coming, you know, hopefully. We have the prison that could be revamped and remodified. We have the Bicentennial Bridge. Those are long-term goals, but as far as the more immediate, the youth, housing, and definitely our drug epidemic.
Okay. All of these things takes resources. In time of financial constraints, how can the city go about increasing revenue, reducing city expenditures, while at the same time lessening the burden on city employees and citizens of Jefferson?
Fundraising is real big. There's always an opportunity to host a big car show, a big swamp meet, a big concert in order to raise funding for different projects that we need in the city. As far as the future, we may need to look at our budget. You know, without looking at the budget, we really can't determine where the money from the taxpayers should actually go. But immediate, there's tons of ways to raise revenue for the city. We have parking lots that we could be charging for parking spaces, especially during events of 4th of July. There's networking with swamp meets to bring in 3 to 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 days necessary to do the types of antique buying that a lot of people around in the community like to do. There's concerts, music festivals, there's eating opportunities to be able to host that event. There's a variety of things the city can do to bring in more funding without touching or, you know, messing with the budget of the employees of the city or changing the budget right away without actually studying the budget to see what the future outcome should be here in the city of Jefferson.
Should city government be seen as being complaint-driven or leadership-driven?
Leadership should always be there, but the people's voices should be heard. So people should be given or afforded the opportunity to make some type of contact in the city to see what their complaint could be. It might be a misunderstanding, it could be some, you know, confusion, but just to be able to voice their opinion. That's the whole entire thing. A person shouldn't just be able to not voice their opinion when they're paying taxes or being a part of a community.
Okay, closing statements. Why should the citizens of Jefferson elect Tiwan Lewis as the next mayor?
You should elect me if you are a real estate agent, if you are trying to buy a house, if you're tired of living paycheck to paycheck, if you want the children to succeed in our community, if you're tired of your burying and your loved ones from drug overdoses, if you're wanting to utilize, you know, interns in your business, if you're trying to save on your budget in your business, if you're trying to create a small business, if you just want to see our community change in a positive way that's going to bring funding, that's going to make people feel like they're a part of a community without having to travel to, say, to Columbia to enjoy events or down to Lake of the Ozark all the time to enjoy events. There's so many ways in order to make change in our city immediately to where people can start to enjoy life again, and that's why you should elect me for change in our city.
Okay. Ms. Lewis, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, we have taken the time to introduce the two candidates that are running for mayor. Silence is an act of consent. Our responsibility is to speak up and speak out. Our challenge is to continue speaking up and speaking out, even when those who are in power seek to silence our voice. Your vote matters. Your vote counts. Don't allow anyone to say your vote does not count. Your participation in the political process will determine who will be the next mayor of the city of Jefferson. History has taught us the importance of being involved, and it has taught us the importance of not being involved, what the impact of that is as well. We'll see you next time. God bless.